National service. You must go for it. There's no two ways about it. Every Singaporean male has to give up 2 years of his life to serve his country. No matter how badly you don't want to go for it, everybody knows you can't avoid it. You can't escape it. And, well, that's not entirely true. I did a bit of digging, and here are a couple of ways to get out of serving NS. The first and possibly worst way is to be a Jehovah's Witness. If you don't know, they're basically a denomination of Christianity. You may even have been approached by some at your doorstep who are trying to convert you. It's a practice they have. Jehovah's Witnesses have many rules, which include but are not limited to not being allowed to celebrate Christmas, Easter, and birthdays. They aren't allowed to have blood transfusions, even if it might save their life. They aren't allowed to salute their country's flag or sing their country's national anthem. And they're not allowed to serve in the military. They aren't allowed to take employment where there's possibility that they might need to use a weapon to kill a human. So what do Jehovah's Witnesses do when it's time for NS? They simply say no and refuse to serve. It's a real thing. It's called conscientious objection. They claim the right to refuse serving NS on the grounds that their religion does not permit them from doing so. It works in that they don't serve NS, but instead they're charged under the Enlistment Act and thrown into the detention barracks for 15 months. If after 15 months they still refuse to serve, they are imprisoned for another 24 months, meaning they effectively serve about 3 years in prison for not going for NS. In the government's eyes, conscientious objection is not a valid reason. Once you're released, you'll be a free man who didn't serve NS. Still, you do have to spend 3 years in prison. Not the best way to avoid national service. Now, the next way doesn't get you out of NS completely, but you get much less strenuous duties. What do you do? Declare homosexuality. Homosexuality in the SAS is classified under the medical code category 302, the code for sexual deviation. It's grouped together with transvestism, exhibitionism, pedophilia, just to name a few. Once homosexuality is declared during the medical checkup, the medical officer will refer the enlistee to the psychological medicine branch of the headquarters of medical services for a thorough psychiatric assessment. During the assessment, the SAS psychologist will ask questions like, are you homosexual? Do you cross-dress? Do you have a boyfriend? Are you the man or the woman? He tries to figure out the enlistee will fit in with the others. The psychologist will also determine the recruit's degree of effeminate behavior through a bunch of arbitrary observations he makes. The higher the perceived level of effeminate behavior, the lower the PES grading you see. Most are downgraded to PES C regardless of their fitness levels. They'll be put through a modified version of basic military training, which is less strenuous. After completing their BMT, they'll be deployed to a vocation which has no security risks, posted to a non-sensitive unit, and be given a security status which restricts access to classified documents. Most become a store clerk for the remainder of the 2 years in NS. While SAF assures that their sexual orientation will be kept confidential, Category 302 personnel have known of other people gaining access to this information as well. If word gets out that one is homosexual, it'll spread like wildfire. According to some openly homosexual men, most people are pretty accepting of it and don't really care too much about it, as there are much more important things to worry about in NS. But some do say that they face emotional bullying from their peers, so they have to be prepared for that. Also, the SAF assures homosexual servicemen that future employers, the civil service, and government agencies do not have access to their SAF medical records. They assure that homosexuals will not be blacklisted. Again, while some homosexual servicemen claim that they have no problems getting jobs, some claim that they could not get jobs in ministries as a result of their sexual orientation being disclosed to the government. So claiming homosexuality may not get you off NS, but it does reduce your duties and it gives you a less stressful time in the army,
provided no one bullies you for your sexual orientation, of course.
Just a quick edit, they don't use the system of judging effeminate behavior through arbitrary observations to determine one's PES status anymore. They found that some gay servicemen try to fake their effeminate mannerisms to get a lower PES grading. So now, the psychiatrist assesses the suitability of a homosexual serviceman for combat training based on his level of fitness rather than on his perceived effeminacy. The third way has many paths, but the main goal is to attain PES F. PES F means you are medically unfit for service, so you don't have to serve at all. People who get PES F either have terminal illnesses like cancer, serious psychological limitations, physical limitations like a missing limb. I'm sure most probably aren't willing to lose an arm just to skip NS, but some are desperate enough to feign severe mental issues. There are a few stories out there, but here's one that was posted to the SAF Confessions page on Facebook. This guy's planning was insane. He began with his plan to bring down his PES a year before even being enlisted. He went to the Institute of Mental Health and managed to get a diagnosis of depression. Come enlistment, he had to shave his head, but he knew that getting MCs from hospitals would be a lot harder with a shaved head as suspicions would arise. So when time came to shave his head, he acted out. He curled up into a ball, clutched his head, and began crying in camp. His OC got overwhelmed and told him that he can shave his head outside of camp, But that 1 hour would be the only time he spent in camp. Once his OC let him out, he immediately began an MC spree. He went to polyclinics all over the country and got 5-day MCs, 3-day MCs, 4-day MCs. After a while, he realized he could only get 1-day MCs. He suspected that the SAF instructed hospitals to limit his MCs. To counter this, he started impersonating officers and pilots. He even got his friends to dress up as his superiors and had them bring him in on a wheelchair to the A&E. And it worked. He got longer MCs. But he was almost caught because after a month of taking MCs, members of parliament went to his house and found that he wasn't home. He was out. An NS man is not allowed to leave his house when he is on MC. It is a rule. An officer threatened to charge him for it. Our man on a journey to Pass F began yelling in a manic voice that he was home but he had taken sleeping pills prescribed by the doctor and that he would go to his MP and the press to report about how they have been harassing him. The officer backed off. Knowing that the SAF was still suspicious of him and they would try anything to expose him, he checked himself into INH and stayed there for a while. Finally, he was scheduled to see an SAF psychiatrist who downgraded him to Pass F and gave him a 2-month MC while they did the administrative work to downgrade him. Oh, and I forgot to mention, he was still getting paid the whole time he was on MC, because technically speaking, he was still an NS man the whole time. This method takes a lot of dedication and a lack of a conscience to feign mental illness. Is it really worth it? The last way has no lying, no faking, no claiming to be something you aren't. It's a 100% legal method. Renounce your citizenship. But you can't just up and leave the country to do that. Otherwise, when you return, you'll immediately get arrested because it's a violation of the Enlistment Act. If you want to leave the country, you gotta do it under the right circumstances. First off, one of your parents has to get a job overseas, and you have to stay in that country long enough to become a citizen and get a passport. And it has to be before you reach the age of 11. Your parents also have to inform MINDEF of your intention to renounce your Singaporean citizenship. At the age of 13, your parents have to apply for exit permits for you to continue to stay overseas legally. Once you're 18, you need to obtain deferment till you're 21, at which point you can finally legally renounce your Singaporean citizenship. Also, you can't use any of the benefits of a Singaporean citizenship the whole time. This dual citizenship method is a long, tedious process, and if you mess up any small thing in the whole process, to NS you go. Well, there you have it. One way gets you in prison for 3 years. For the other, you need to lie about your sexual orientation. Another requires you to take advantage of how difficult it is to diagnose mental illnesses and not feel guilty about it. And the actual legal way is so difficult that going for NS is probably the smarter option.